Snuggs for absoluteradio.co.uk, talking to the legend that is Sir Geoff Hurst. How are you doing?
Hello, very well, thank you. All right.
Obviously, I'm going to ask you about Fabio Capello's squad and the England's chances, but can you just take us back to that day, that remarkable day back in 1966 when you scored that incredible hat-trick? Some say it was the perfect hat-trick. You scored with your head, your right, and then your left foot. Can you just tell us, how did that feel?
I can't remember that far back.
Yes, you can.
Well, what do you think it feels like? It's a great day to play for your country initially, to represent your country in any sport is just fantastic. To play in a World Cup final is better. To play at Wembley is amazing. And to win a World Cup final against a great German side is something you really don't really dream about. And for me, the memories are fantastic. But more recently, I've tended to focus on other people's memories. And you realise how important, how significant it is for the national team to be involved in the World Cup and be successful. Or in any sport. It's Ashes at cricket, it's the Rugby World Cup in 2003. They're national events which transcend the sport. And I think we could do in this country currently, it's quite an obvious thing to say, a huge fillip for us to be successful in this World Cup. It couldn't come at a better time for the country's recessionary problems.
Just before I move on to our chances, England's chances in just a few weeks' time. Now, some say that your second goal wasn't actually a goal, and even last month, April Fool's Day, you kind of joked and sort of revealed that actually you knew all along it wasn't a proper goal before sort of retracting that the next day. What are your genuine thoughts on that?
Well, I think you believe it's a goal. I think when you play, because I mentioned earlier about playing for England in a World Cup against Germany in a final, and a goal hits a bar and go, you want to believe more than anything else in your being that the ball is over the line. And I have that strong feeling that it was in. Nothing's ever proved conclusively. If you look at the stills and the evidence, still proves inconclusive. The person that always says it was a goal was my striking partner from Liverpool, Roger Hunt, a great Liverpool striker. And instinctively, he was following in, and he would have put it in had he not thought it was in. He turned away, shouted, "It's a goal." And really, that's really been good enough for me for the past 44 years now. But it's a question, because you realise how significant reaching a final is. People still talk about, like you're today, talk about the goal and ask me almost weekly, was the ball over the line?
So yeah.
I think it's a belief. You just want to believe, because of the situation you find yourself, drawing 2-2, you just want to believe that ball's over the line.
You're the only footballer to have scored a hat-trick in a World Cup final. A few have come close. Are you secretly hoping that you'll hold on to that record for some years to come?
Well, I always jokingly say that it'd be nice. I hope we're successful. I'm an England fan, as we all are, and people say you a cynic. One or two cynics say you don't want England to win. You don't want England to. You don't want to score. Anybody to score three, which is nonsense. I mean, I desperately want us to be successful this year. I understand, as I said earlier, me and 21 other guys, how important it is for us to be successful, because I know people's feelings. I hope we can win the final 4-0 and Rooney and Gerrard get 2 each.
Okay, well, let's just talk about Fabio Capello's men. Those two guys obviously have made the squad. What do you think about Capello's choices? Because there are a few surprises in there. Adam Johnson's in there, Ledley King. Some say that Capello's taking a bit of a risk with Ledley King because obviously he's had lots of injuries. What are your thoughts on the squad?
Well, I think the squad is much as you had expected, almost to a man. I mean, you mentioned a couple of people not in there, but you could mention half a dozen, 7 or 8 players that have been around. But I think it's much as we've expected. I think the inclusion of 1 or 2 players who had good years to the clubs, which is really what Fabio Capello has said, that you pick players who are in form. And you look at the Tottenham 3, Dawson, Ledley King, and Huddleston. Adam Johnson's come on really well and performed well for a big club, a really big club at Man City in a tough time. Scott Parker at West Ham's had a good season. Darren Bent is a player that scored 24 league goals and deserves a place to be in the squad. So much as expected. I think there's a concern about the depth of the squad I mentioned earlier, and a concern particularly in the centre-back position with injury-prone players. John Terry's had a few knocks. Rio Ferdinand's only played 11 to 12 games this year. And Martin Peters, who scored a goal in the final in 66, who watches Spurs play, he makes the point Ledley King is a great player, deserves to be in the squad. And he makes the point in terms of the injuries that he's played more games than Rio Ferdinand. And as much as many professionals and the managers who pick teams would not want to pick players who have a suspect injury, or certainly in Ledley King's place, doesn't play many games. I think there's a strong case in this particular World Cup, going against what most pros would believe, of picking him in the squad. I think you can play, let's say, every other game because of his quality if we have a problem with the other two. And I'd rather pick a player that can play every other game that's capable of playing well than perhaps a player that's not going to perform well when he comes in. So there's a strong case for me in picking Ledley King at this stage.
Wayne Rooney, obviously a key player.
Wayne who?
Who, never heard of him. He's had a few knocks himself recently. Do you think too much pressure's been put on his shoulders?
No, there's pressure to play, pressure to perform when you get to the national side. He's used to that with Man United. Every game they play is a pressure game. Playing in the league all season, playing in the Champions League up until recently when they were knocked out. They're big pressure games. He's been playing in that pressure cooker atmosphere since he was 15 or 16 at Everton, so he's fairly used to it. He's a fairly seasoned player now and has matured very well on off the pitch. So I don't think so. It's part and parcel of it. I think with the pressure on to make sure we keep him on the field, that's the pressure. We keep him playing, because I think you do need your key players like that. Certainly in the latter part of the competition. I'm not sure whether you desperately miss him in the first three games. I think you could qualify arguably without him. If you're going to be successful and get to the final, then you need players like Wayne Rooney in the latter stage of the competition when you're up against the big boys. So that's he's a key player, as is Steven Gerrard, as is Alan Pogba. Every country has four or five players like that who they can't afford to lose, and you never can tell what will happen in a World Cup. But I think you cope with it, and I think he's had a fantastic season. I think the fact he's had a couple of knocks recently and had a bit of a rest is actually in England's favour. I really do. And coming off in the last game with a slight groin strain, I think now he'll be pretty fresh. And I think it's important coming to the end of a long season that players fortunately have a bit of a breather in a long season. Maybe the better for England because we may benefit from those couple of little breathers he's had, and one or two other players.
Now, England are without David Beckham, which is a massive, massive blow, not only for Bex himself, but for England. This would have been his fourth World Cup, but Capello has invited him to come along anyway. How much of a blow is it to the squad to have him not playing?
I don't think David has not been a regular starter. He's come on as a squad player in the last 5 or 10 minutes in certain games, tactically and strategically used to because he's very good at holding the ball and containing the opposition. And it'd be due tactically. So I don't think he's not a player that would have the impact of losing a Wayne Rooney now or Steven Gerrard because of his age factor. So I don't think he's necessarily a blow to the team because he's not a regular first team player now. It's a blow for David personally. I think he looked like he was going to be in the squad and play four World Cups, which would be a fantastic achievement. In terms of the squad, I don't think it's a real big blow.
Now, what do you think are England's chances of winning? Do you think they can repeat 1966 and go and lift that trophy?
Well, I would say that the squad now is as well prepared as they've been for some time. I think the management of Fabio Capello with the staff has been fantastic. There's a lot more discipline and respect in the squad. And as a fan, as we all are, I think we're going to this World Cup being well prepared. I think we have I think at the very least, this squad and myself and the country will be extremely disappointed this time if we don't get at least to the semi-final. And if you keep your best players on the field and have a run and a fair win, you never know. But then you're up against the big boys, the Spains and Brazils. I'm just feeling, I have, one or two doubts. There's probably, I'm not saying anything new that hasn't already been said. Having spoken to Gordon Banks and Peter Shilton in the last couple of weeks, strangely enough, about the goalkeeper, and they have concerns about, they're the experts, not me, about the goalkeeping position. And up front, Heskey will be number one choice to play alongside Wayne Rooney. Hasn't played much this year, not scoring many goals. So there is a concern about the squad in depth. And it certainly, and this is the case in my time, it is not 11 players that wins a World Cup. 11 players may be remembered from our time. It's 14 or 15 players who participate, come on as sub and play the odd game. And sometimes it's the five or six players who are not involved at all in playing can add to the camaraderie and team spirit of the squad. So very seriously, it's a squad that wins a World Cup, not just 11 players. And that's important. And that team spirit they generate and the strength and quality and depth of it are important for us winning. So, but I think we've got a chance. I'm just a concern at the latter end of the competition whether we have enough strength in depth. And certainly if we do get a couple of key players injured, we are, then I think we would have a problem. But you never know. You never know. And we, with a fair win, they're keeping players on the field through suspensions and injuries. You never know what can happen in the sport.
Where will you be watching it? Are you going to South Africa?
I'm going for the opening ceremony, the opening game in England's first game in Joburg. For that, I'm working back here for the second game. I think subsequently, if we progress a bit further down the line, I think I'll be fairly busy. I would think if we get to the quarters, semis and the final, I should be fairly busy one way or another, either here or in South Africa.
You must be very excited about it, obviously.
I am. I'm into. I enjoyed the World Cup immensely. I went to the World Cup with McDonald's, all the people over there in 2006. We had a car, we travelled all to see all the games, did a bit of work, a bit of PR work for McDonald's, and it was absolutely fantastic. I thoroughly enjoyed. I worked, you know, I got a bit in front of the media for my role as McDonald's director of football. I did enjoy it immensely, and I'll be looking forward to it this time. Sadly, it's a bit too far away for people to go on a regular basis or to spend the month there, but I've been to South Africa before. I've been to Cape Town, which is one of the most beautiful places I've been to. I would love this to get progress and they get to a semi-final in Cape Town. I think that would be very nice. Meet some pals of mine who are over. John Sissons, I played at West Ham. George Eastham at Stoke City. Terry Payne's out there who played in their World Cup squad. It'd be a really lovely visit if we progress down the line. I would jump at the opportunity to go.
Wouldn't we all? I just got to ask you about the captaincy. Obviously, John Terry was sacked because of allegations about his private life and Rio Ferdinand has taken over. What did you make of that whole episode?
Well, I think the decision, I think, was very quick. I think the handling it, you can argue all day about whether the rights and wrongs of what happened, but I think the handling it, that's important from a football point of view, with Capello was very, very decisive, much in Alf Ramsey's time. He took 12 minutes to say, you've lost the captaincy, but you're still playing. And I think on balance, for me, that was just about the right decision. And it was handled quickly, and it's water under the bridge now. I wouldn't really want to say any more than that. But I think the decision, what happened, is just about spot on. The speed at which it happened, and the decisiveness, and I think absolutely quickly, it was absolutely the right decision for the future.
Well, listen, Sir Geoff Hurst, it's been an absolute pleasure talking to you. Enjoy the World Cup as you know we all will, and let's hope that we can repeat the success that you had in 1966.
It'd be fantastic, and nobody knows more than me and 21 other guys how important enough to us to be successful in the World Cup.
Thank you very much.
Pleasure, you're welcome.